So the majority of comments I read on my last video were asking for a deep dive on our boy Cho Sang-woo, also known as Player 218, the man with the triangle, or Sangmundong's golden child who graduated first in his class at SNU Business School. By the way, he also graduated from SNU. I wanted to discuss his approach to the games and his reasoning behind his snake-like decisions that made everyone go like, bruh. Why? Oh, by the way, it's your friendly neighborhood spoilers. There will be spoilers. In an interview with The Hollywood Reporter, the series director Hwang Dong-yao talks about the conception of the character Sung-woo, claiming the names of the characters Seong Gi-hun, Cho Sung-woo, and Ilam are all names of his friends. Cho Sung-woo is a childhood friend of his, and they used to play in the alleyways together. Sung-woo graduated first in his class from SNU Business School, and worked as a supervisor of Team 2 at Joy Investments. So what's Sangmundong's prodigy doing in the games? Sung-woo has a warrant out for his arrest for forgery of private documents, embezzlement, and basically fraud. On the island, the organization claims that Sung-woo owes 650 million won. But in reality, it's much worse, as the total amount he owes is 6 billion won. When converted to US currency, that's around $5 million. When this square guard was reading off everyone's debts, each player owed around the same amount of money, with the average being around 800 million won. However, the organization was unaware of Sung-woo's situation, thus underestimating his desperation. When Sung-woo powers on his phone, you can see him get a bunch of notifications. Once translated, these notifications give us some information as to how much trouble Sung-woo is actually in, as he's getting contacted by the Financial Supervisory Service, Cyber National Police Agency, SP Savings Bank, Seoul Provincial Police Station, and the Economic Criminal Division of Seoul's Prosecutor's Office. Just a little bit of trouble. Sung-woo was basically using his supervising position at Joy Investments to siphon off money from his clients' portfolios. Then he invested the stolen money into options and futures that all failed, which is kind of illegal. By the way, if you're like me or Gi-hun and have a gross misunderstanding of how the stock market works, futures are contracts that allow a buyer or a seller to bet on the future price of a stock, currency, product, etc. It's an incredibly high-risk investment strategy that takes full advantage of the price fluctuation of the market. If your prediction is correct, depending on your contract, you can receive an enormous amount of money. But if you lose, you lose a lot. So when betting on these futures, he ended up betting his mother's shop and house as financial collateral. It's funny how during the second game, Sung-woo says that there's a saying in investing, don't put all your eggs in one basket, which is exactly what he did to get himself 6 billion won in debt. I know, right? It's hard to believe that someone who graduated first in their class at SNU Business School would make such a decision. So in order to avoid his trials, Sung-woo convinced everyone that he's on a business trip in the United States. This is actually kind of tragic because the only other person who knew what happened to Sung-woo can't say anything about his death. So people like Sung-woo's mother are left to assume that he just fled the country, went missing, or took his own life, but will never actually get closure. Taking his own life was going to be the second part of Sung-woo avoiding his trial. In episode 2, he's seen burning charcoal on a hot plate in an enclosed space, which is not really a conventional method in Western culture, but burning charcoal in his bathroom with the door closed would soon cause him to die from carbon monoxide poisoning. Sung-woo was almost gone until the organization gave him another card, with an offer to meet at the same place to re-enter the games. Sadly, we did not get to see Sung-woo's profile, but I'd imagine it would look something like this. Speaking of which, did you know that he graduated? While we're on the topic of player profiles, I can't believe I didn't notice this detail before. When Jin-ho is going through list 1 of the players in Squid Game 2020, the book immediately opens to player 2, revealing that player 1's profile is missing from the archives. Because why would they need a record of the host? Such a cool detail hinting at the fact that number 1 is running the games. To say that Sung-woo operates with no empathy or remorse is a misguided assumption. I mean, don't worry, this isn't a Sung-woo did nothing wrong video. I haven't lost my marbles. In fact, I have all my marbles, unlike Ali. But Sung-woo is not entirely in the wrong during the season. Let us not forget that in episode 2, Hell, Sung-woo was the one to bring up Clause 3, a clause stating that if the majority of players agree to stop playing, the games are allowed to end. Out of the entire room of scared people, including this guy, Sung-woo was the one to stand up to the guards with all their guns and stuff. Sung-woo's actions are what initially initiated the voting process of whether or not they were going to continue the games. But it wasn't until he saw the money that his survival instincts kicked in and he started acting like a snake. If numbers 1 and 456 represent those on opposite ends of the spectrum when it comes to wealth and those who are valued by society, it's fitting that Sung-woo would be in the middle as number 218. It's implied that number 1 was willing to sacrifice everything for his financial state, which is most likely why his wife and kids are no longer in his life, while number 456 is constantly trying to maintain a certain code of ethics and principles. Then, 218 is in the middle, torn between these two mindsets. However, Sung-woo can't keep that business school side of himself at bay. During the vote to continue the games or not, around 50% of the players were not wanting to continue and voted no, but Sung-woo voted yes, meaning he was willing to put 50% of the players' lives at risk for his own chance of getting the prize money. So from the start, Sung-woo was selfish enough to sacrifice the lives of others for his own personal gain. Gosh, even Elon wanted to play but voted no when there was a tiebreaker because he didn't want people to play who didn't want to. Are you happy, Sung-woo? In this situation, you're worse than the host. It's not that Sung-woo and Gi-hun don't share the same kind of morals. I mean, they both had similar upbringings, as they were raised by hardworking mothers in the same town. They both have charitable tendencies, like giving their food to Ali. And on different occasions, Sung-woo and Gi-hun both gave away 10,000 won to people they didn't know. Except, unlike Gi-hun, Sung-woo never asks for it back. They both even come back to the games for similar reasons. Gi-hun needing to pay for his mother's medical treatments, and Sung-woo needing to save his mother's store and house from getting taken away. Also, they both are the reason their mothers are in financial ruin by betting their money and assets away. It's like they are equally reckless. In an interview with CNN, Wang Dong-yao claimed that Gi-hun and Sung-woo represent two sides of himself. Like Gi-hun, he was raised by a single mother in a financially troubled environment in Sangmundong. And at the same time, like Sung-woo, he went to Seoul National University, and his entire neighborhood praised him and had high expectations for him. That's something I really like about the subtext of this show. Jokes aside, what shaped Sung-woo was him going to SNU and having to live up to everyone's unrealistic expectations of him becoming incredibly successful and wealthy, adding an immense amount of pressure on him growing up and in his adult life. When we see his mom, the only thing she talks about after all these years is him graduating from SNU and how he's like the promised one. So when Sung-woo cuts Gi-hun off from reminding everyone in their pet rock about SNU, it's less about him being annoyed by Gi-hun and more about him living with the shame of never meeting the expectations of others, as all the people placing this burden on him is what must have pushed him to take on such a high-risk investment strategy. The main difference between Gi-hun and Sung-woo is that Sung-woo has a business degree from SNU, obviously, but because of this, Sung-woo understands what it's like to compete in an incredibly unforgiving market. This is shown to us in the games, as he's quick to adapt and understand the necessary measures he has to take in order to come out the other side with all the prize money. Sung-woo's decisions are based on logic, while Gi-hun's decisions are based on emotion. So when people are saying that Sung-woo was too merciless during the games, his reasoning behind such behavior is kind of justified. Like, if you're gonna sign up for the death games, it's probably not a good idea to make or maintain friendships with anyone, as those relationships could drag you down, which was his reasoning for separating and subsequently sabotaging his team during the second game. The only person Sung-woo becomes close with is Ali, because Ali is very capable and loyal and also naive. But like any modern manager, CEO, or company, he rewards that loyalty by betraying the trust of his recruit when their relationship is no longer entirely beneficial. In episode 4, Sabiao tells Gi-hun that she doesn't trust people, and Gi-hun responds to this by telling her that you don't trust people because you can, you trust people because you have nothing else to lean on. During the marble game, we see Gi-hun and Sung-woo exploit the trust of others. Both were willing to mislead and take advantage of the other players in order to assure their own survival. In this case, the only difference between the two is that Gi-hun, once again, got lucky, as his partner gave up. I think it speaks volumes that everyone is upset with how Sung-woo navigated through the games. It was merciless, but it was necessary. Because if it wasn't for Sung-woo's quick thinking, like pushing number 17 off the ledge, then Gi-hun would be the current definition of dead. Now, pushing player 17 through a piece of glass very much seemed like a psychopathic move, but to be fair, player 17 had 30 plus years of experience in glass manufacturing. This game was his jam, but he chose not to take the lead and save all 14 lives of the players who went before him. In the next episode, Gi-hun and Sung-woo have it out. Gi-hun tries holding Sung-woo responsible for his actions, and Sung-woo defends himself, saying that he's alive because he worked his ass off to be alive, and claims that Gi-hun choosing the last number out of luck was making him feel generous. Gi-hun going from 456 to number 1 to number 16 is a good representation of lucky people getting put into more fortunate situations within our society. But from their secure spot, they still feel they're able to judge the actions of those who were put in a less fortunate situation, as they can't fully understand the desperate measures that had to be taken to assure the unlucky one's survival. Sung-woo, being the unlucky player, was put in front of Seong Gi-hun and had to make an incredibly hard time-sensitive decision. In the interview with CNN, the one that I was talking about earlier in the video, Hwang Dong-yao said more words, specifically talking about the origin of Squid Game, explaining having grown into an adult, the question, what would it be like to go back and play those childhood games again, was the start to the creation of the entire series. I feel this juxtaposition of adults and childhood games is blatant commentary on the loss of innocence one goes through when becoming a functioning adult in a more competitive society, as everything turns into life or death. In my last video about Seong Gi-hun, I briefly talked about the song choice of Fly Me to the Moon by Bart Howard playing at the end of episode 1, explaining that the song was originally written in 1954, yet the meaning behind the use of the song is a little bit more modern. In stock trading, crypto, and other money laundering ventures, the expression take me to the moon is extremely common, especially when talking about Doge or Tesla. And not the Squid Game coin, apparently. Getting taken to the moon is having your extremely risky bets pay off. Everyone in Squid Game is competing for a whole bunch of money, whether it's the rich VIPs placing bets on the players or the players betting on themselves to win. Everyone is taking a gamble to receive an astronomical reward, hence the use of Fly Me to the Moon. The rocket man of this series is Sung-woo, as he's the one continuously aiming for the moon, getting progressively more and more violent throughout the games, taking things too far and making it so he can never go back. Before he takes his own life, Sung-woo mentions how their mothers used to call their names when supper was ready, and how that won't happen again. This entire season, Sung-woo is trying to get to the moon, but this is the moment where he's brought back down to Earth. Later in the episode, Number One talks about how he felt alive during his youth, and Gi-hun opens the series with the last time he felt truly exhilarated, which was playing Squid Game as a kid. Sung-woo reflecting on his childhood is a good indication that he recognizes the core values he lost as he entered a system that demanded so much from him. He realizes he lost the fight with Gi-hun, and also understands how the world on the outside works. This competition was always life or death for him, and knowing that Gi-hun has integrity, Sung-woo trusts him to take care of his mom, and is left with no other option but to take his own life so Gi-hun then gets the prize money. In my opinion, Sung-woo redeemed himself during this moment, but to say that what Sung-woo did to Se-biao makes him irredeemable, well, yeah, no, that's fair. I'm not gonna argue with that. That concludes part one of my Sung-woo deep dive. If you liked this video or just thought it was adequate, comment below which characters you want to see me analyze next. And as promised, I will pick the character with the most amount of comments. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you in my next Squid Game Explained video.